how inspiring obtaining a Ph.D.
That was going to be, we will go in the same route.
Yep. You would not, go ahead.
No.
Great minds.
Yeah, exactly.
All three.
Yes.
Like, that's such a major accomplishment, a major feat, you know, especially for our culture. Can you take us on that journey of what that experience pretty much
was like?
You see his face?
Yeah, he's like,
hey.
They say he didn't do that for the marathon, but now he's like,
Yeah.
I remember somebody asked me once, you know, which is harder, the PhD or the marathon? I said, well, I will do the marathon again. Here's how this PhD happened. So I did my undergrad at Columbia engineering, electrical engineering, and then I worked for a year. I worked at Merrill Lynch for a little while. Right after undergrad, I was a business analyst in their technology division. This is 2008. Around then was the financial crisis, right?
Right.
So Merrill Lynch was acquired by Bank of America that summer. And I told myself, okay, just in case I get laid off, I need to have a plan B. So I was an international student, so I was an F1 visa, so I need to be either working or in school. That fall, and I studied GRE, I applied to grad school, whatever. Then in January 2009, I remember it was a Thursday, got laid off. I walked in one morning and just hundreds of us just got sent home. Just like no warning, nothing, just like sent home.
Wow.
And I remember I left for work that morning and I was back home by 10 a.m. because they just sent us.
Exactly. Home.
Yeah. So that was a Thursday. This Saturday, I found that I got into Columbia for grad school. Okay. So I was like, okay. I have a plan. My plan B, you know, is working. So like that summer, so that spring to summer, to kind of make ends meet, I was like working at a church, I was doing like basically like cleaning and that kind of stuff. Like, I'm a hustler. I've been hustling.
No shame in that.
Yo, no shame. I was cleaning and stuff with the church. I would help with some custodial stuff and like facilities management is what kind of coined it. So then I started my master's September 2009. No intention of doing a PhD.
Okay.
Just wanted to get his master's and write out. As I was coming to the end of my master's, I was struggling to find a job I wanted to do. The market really wasn't back, and I couldn't find anything. Just around then, my department, the engineering department at Columbia, the electrical engineering department at Columbia approached me and said, hey, we will like to pay for your PhD if you want to do it. And I'm like, thanks, but no thanks. I'm like, no.
Really?
Why would I? Why? I had no desire to do a PhD. And they're like, we'll cover your funding that you have for a number of years, and then you could. I was like,
wait, they're willing to pay for your education?
Yeah,
you don't have to pay it.
Right. So, because my thing was, I think PhDs and, now going through it, PhDs are for a very specific kind of person, a very specific type of, you need to want to do a PhD to do it. Right? It's not going to be just like stumble upon like I did.
Yeah.
And I was talking to my family and I was like, do it, boy, let's go.
Exactly.
I was like, what's wrong with you? So, do the degree and do I don't know what's wrong with this chat. So, I thought about somewhere and decided, I'm going to start the PhD and continue job hunting. And when I find the job I want to do, I'm going to drop out. And that was my plan in my head,
Yeah.
So, there was funding, I could keep looking for my job or whatever. But as I got into it, I kind of started, appreciating the process, you know, and really got into my research area. And one of the things that also, like, to this day keeps coming back to my mind is during my master's graduation. So the master's graduation was in May 2010, so I'd already started the PhD. I started PhD in January 2010.
Okay.
Yeah, because
the overlap?
The overlap of how that worked. Because I was done with the master's. The master's is three semesters.
Okay.
But there's one graduation at Columbia. So I was done with the master's in December. I started, So like I was transitioning out of the master's to the PhD during at the end of 2010. And then I graduated, I walked in 2011 with my master's.
Okay.
So during my master's graduation, I remember looking around and seeing only three black people in the engineering school graduating with a master's.
Yeah.
And we knew each other, right? Mm-hmm. I always thought there would be more of us. So maybe there were more, I just didn't see them on the X or so. But and that really hit me. I'm like, this is significant, you know, me actually continuing with the PhD at Columbia University. In the engineering school is significant for a man of color at the University of Columbia.
Yeah.
So there was that additional motivation or like incentive to outside of myself. Like, yes, by that point, you know, I was committed to doing a PhD, I was starting to fall in love with the process. But then also there was like outside of me. What does this mean for, you know, little brown boys and girls, little black boys and girls, seeing me complete this? So that definitely had played a part in me continuing with the PhD. So I, so the next few years was just a lot of headache. in terms of, so you have, you finish your coursework, for your master's you finish your coursework, and then for your PhD at Columbia, you have like another 30 or so credits of coursework you do.
Okay.
And then you kind of like start focusing on your research only and writing papers and stuff.
Okay.
The big difference between, and I've found that the jump from bachelor's to master's is much smaller than the jump from master's to PhD.
I can see that.
It's a much bigger gap because as a doctoral candidate, as a PhD, someone with a PhD, you are moving from someone consuming knowledge to someone who's now creating that knowledge and critiquing knowledge. And that transition is difficult. Going from like a student and there's, you know, reading other people's papers and analyzing it, you are now the one writing those papers, critiquing other people's work, critiquing your own work. When it, if you're doing a PhD right, your contribution isn't out there yet. Right? So there's no back of the textbook to tell you if you're right or wrong.
Right.
So then how do you, you know, verify that what you're producing is correct?
Right.
That's one, you know, being able to critique your own work, presenting at conferences, having other people look at your work and provide you feedback. So that transition from like a master's student into a PhD student into someone, you know, contributing to the field is it can be challenging.
Mm-hmm.
It is challenging. Because you're not necessarily taught to think like that during undergrad or master's.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I struggled with that for a little bit, that transition. And but coming out of it, like I think differently now. Like I it's just, it's hard to explain, but like, you view the world differently. I feel like after I've come out of the PhD, I feel like I don't know anything. I understand that I know a lot about a very specific thing, but I'm aware of how much I do not know. And I think that is powerful as you move through the world, acknowledging and knowing that you don't know a thing. Because you then view the world as like a whole learning experience. Like everything, you want to learn something. You know that you don't know stuff, so you're curious. You're constantly curious.
Yeah.
And I think coming out of the PhD process has made me more curious about the world. So that's kind of like high level. I think like some of my bigger challenges was convincing people that what I was doing was significant. And you know, like, how do you tell a story about something as like technical and dry as privacy and cloud computing? You have to show why it's relevant to people. Mm-hmm. You know, and that also was challenging. Like my advisor, I had a great. Actually, he went to undergrad here. My advisor, Nicholas Maxenchuk.
Okay.
He went to undergrad here, and he was very helpful in guiding me through how to think about complex problems, breaking it down, mm-hmm. and then also telling a story about the solution to that problem. Mm-hmm. And I'm forever grateful for his guidance because mm-hmm. it helps you frame stories. It helps you frame lessons. You connect. The goal is to be empathetic to your audience mm-hmm. and understand your audience, and then you decide what and how you share the information. So at the beginning, I used to like try to like spew out all these like formulas and specifics and stuff. People don't care about that. People don't care about that. And depending on the conference you're at, and depending on the audience you're talking to, they don't care. What you want to do is talk about the value. Talk about why it's important, how it's important. And the people who care about the specifics, mm-hmm. they will read your paper, mm-hmm. and they will ask questions in the Q&A about the technical mm-hmm. stuff.
Okay.
When
okay.
you present at the beginning, okay. you give a big picture, overall, like, this is what I'm doing, why I'm doing it, how I'm doing it, mm-hmm. and this is how it relates to the real world. Mm-hmm. And people, and if you do that well, if you explain it well, it will generate questions.
Right.
It'll generate questions.
Mm-hmm. You just gave a outline and tutorial how to give a presentation.
Yeah.
Everything. Just yeah. the whole thing and then question and answer. You can answer that. I'm going back to this.
Right, yeah.
You and this girl. I'm just like, no. Damn, I'm sorry. Damn.
So, I learned a lot throughout the PhD process. I learned a lot about myself, clearly, like the engineering stuff. Mm-hmm. I would not do it again. Maybe no time soon. And you know, sometimes people have asked, like, do you recommend that you get a
right,
get a
right,
PhD?
Right, right.
It really depends on what you want to do with your life.
Right.
Okay. There are some fields, some, you know, career trajectories that don't require a PhD. And there's a lot of celebration around, you know, getting peace. There's a lot of, you know, honor and respect. Mm-hmm. And the challenge, the problem with that sometimes is that we may be pushing, especially like our black and brown kids, into that mm-hmm. direction without really having a conversation with them about, like, what do you want to achieve?
Like a plan. Yeah.
What's your plan? Like,
very good.
Thinking purely academic isn't necessarily the answer to this. It's maybe a part of it, but mm-hmm. it's not the only thing that they should be thinking about, mm. you know? So if someone approaches me and they said they're thinking about doing a PhD, they're not sure, I said, don't do it. Don't do it. You have to know that you want to do it. You have to know that it's going to further you in that field. Mm-hmm. You have to understand the implications of doing a PhD. You have to understand why you're sacrificing into a PhD. You're not gaining experience for years when you're doing a PhD. You may gain a little academic stuff, internships here and there.
Yeah.
But you're off the market for years. Mm. So for some, in some areas, that is detrimental. That is detrimental to your career.
Yeah.
You may be better off just sticking with your bachelor's degree and getting work
really?
And being strategic and like finding jobs that will move you forward, finding roles that will give you that experience, those connections that would put you in a place that you could then empower other people. So going through a PhD or even like a master's isn't always the answer.
Yeah.
It can be. I'm not
right.
I am pro education.
Yeah.
I am also aware of the shortcomings of education, the way it's set up right now, the implications it has on our population.
That's right. That's right.
And we have to be aware of that. We have to be aware of how this whole system works.
Great.
Right.
And education today. Okay, well.
Because he's answering my question.
Yeah.
I'm trying to get his answer to him already.
Right.
Sorry.
He's answering my question.
I would not take back if I were to relive my life, I would do my PhD again.
Mm-hmm.
I would do it again. I think it's what I should have done for me. I would have done it differently. I would have, leading up to it, during it, I would have done things very differently. Mm-hmm. But, and I probably would have finished sooner. But I think it's what I needed for my life, and works for me. Mm-hmm.
I'm glad you mentioned that. And Kyle, you let me know you're an educator.
Yes.
Both of you are educated. I'm just learning from y'all.
You and your weight as well.
I'm on my way. They're saying, according, you know, that a high school diploma back in the day was something that you needed at least to get a job or whatever, you know, when you were growing up.
Like pre, what, 19, late 70s, 80s, when they started to implement, like, the trajectory of going to college, getting a degree over the person who has the years of experience. In America, from what I've been told, that pre 75, 80, it was work experience. I don't care if you got a degree or not. This person's been on a job for 10 years. You just came out of college. We're picking them to move them up. They said after post 1975, 1980 is when the trajectory of getting a degree superseded the experience at a job. Mm-hmm. Like, that's when the yuppies and all that type of stuff came in, the Reagan era. Mm-hmm. And they said that's when that changed. Mm-hmm. And it was like, oh, you got a degree. Oh, great. We're going to take you over this person here. Right. Even they got 10 years experience. So it's like,
So, a bachelor's degree was the standard, I guess.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Now they're saying a bachelor's degree is equivalent to a high school diploma, and you need your master's degree. Mm-hmm. So a lot of these young people growing up and going to school are being fed that. Mm-hmm. So from your experience, how relevant, like you said, there's certain positions, like I don't want a doctor who doesn't, you know, a brain surgeon.
You
need to be matriculating in certain fields, therapy, dealing with the mind, you know, so, but for the most part, what they're trying to promote and ingrain and indoctrinate a lot of young people is the general school mantra, whatever the case is, that you need at least a master's degree now to get a good job and things of that nature.
Correct.
What is your opinion on that, as opposed to just experience? Because I hear Google now is hiring people, from what I heard, who don't even have masters. They're hiring people who have the experience.
Yeah, 2 years so experience.
Yeah,
2 years.
Yeah, if you just go on any like job posting website, and you would find some of these bigger companies are hiring people without degrees who have the experience doing certain things. Again, it depends on where you're trying to go. Like some fields, like you need that degree, you need to show that you know the content in the field that you're getting into.
Yeah, teacher, professor.
Yeah, one of them. You know, so like in academia, like you need to know all the information.
You better know it.
Right. You need to know it, but also how to research, how to critique things.
Yeah.
I think it's more important for students to learn those skills throughout their academic careers. And we've moved away from instruction or learning experiences that empower students to develop those skills. Like we're now in an age where we're testing, you know? So what testing does is it forces educators to teach to a test, especially if your funding is tied to your students doing well, you are going to ensure that your students pass this test. But they don't leave your classroom, your school, knowing how to operate in the world or how to apply that knowledge.
Right.
You teach the test, they forget most of it by over the summer, and then you kind of like start all over again in the fall.
Right.
And you know, you get through, you know, you go through elementary, middle, high school, passing tests, and then you get to college or in the real world and you don't know anything.
Right.
And that's a problem. So, and it's not that I'm pro education. I'm against the whole like regurgitation of information approach to education. And education is meant to benefit a society, to prepare its citizens to be contributors to the society. Because our current education system within most of the US is outdated. You know, it's outdated.
Yeah.
And depending on, you know, the school you go to, the neighborhood you go in, they are not teaching to the test.
Mm.
They are providing students with like these like learning experiences.
Rich experiences.
You know, these have them thinking outside the box. And
Problem solving. Especially being an engineer.
Exactly.
Yeah,
that's what education is supposed to prepare you for the real world. And they still do well in the tests.
Yeah.
They still do well in the tests, you know, because like that type of thinking, that type of approach to education also covers content and knowledge.
Does that tie into, like you said, there's a difference between understanding and knowledge?
Yes. So, you know, students doing, you know, like project-based learning and doing learning experiences where they're interviewing people, where they're going out, where they're like uncovering information, where they're just being forced to think critically, they will learn, you know, like 1 + 1 = 2. They will learn the equations as they go through that process, but they're also getting, you know, presentation skills, problem solving skills, research skills, critical thinking skills. All those things that you probably won't get if you're just in a classroom where you're being taught to the test.
Like Sean, I'll give you one quick example real quick. Like one of the classes at our school in the Bronx, we do these electives. So we have like a tech elective, a culinary elective, and a health elective. So one of the culinary electives is they like bake goods, like cupcakes or cakes or things like that. And I found out from one of the teachers who was in charge of that part of it, she was telling me that the students that we had this semester, most of them had never made anything before, like recipe wise. So they weren't used to following the recipe. They had really never done that.
Right.
But what happened is what astounded us in the past few months is that these have been some of the best cakes and cupcakes that we've ever had. Why? Because they know that they didn't know and they followed the directions to the T. So beforehand, we're like, oh, I got this. I'm gonna just cut this and cut that, and you know. These have been some of the best outputs of cakes and bacon we had in the past 2-3 years. And what we found out, like Sean was saying, is that they are learning how to follow procedure, follow steps, and then with those steps come certain results. So now, in reference of them coming back to our class, it's like, okay, Miss So-and-so, Mr. So-and-so said do it this way, this way, this way. So I'm gonna do it this way, instead of what hasn't been working for me before and just doing it any old way I feel like is comfortable.
Right.
Like, no, they said do it this way, I'm gonna do it this way, this way, this way, and if I have any questions, like, okay, I got into this point, like, where do I go next?
Yeah.
Okay, well, think about it like this. Okay, thank you. And then it's like back to the regular schedule. So it's like, what Sean is saying is right, like those project-based, has a lot more application outside of just making this cupcake or finishing this baked goods.
Yeah.
It has so many more applications to it.
Yeah, so and looking like, you know, the whole idea that, you know, now you need a master's to get a job or whatever. The assumption is that that master's comes with experience as well. It's not like, oh, I have a master's in it.
Right.
You know? Like, I have a master's degree, can I get this job, please? No. They're also assuming that you have experience, right. You know? So there's that. Now, when we think about in terms of entrepreneurial sort of ventures for students to take, you don't necessarily need a master's degree to start a business.
Right.
You know, you don't need a bachelor's to start a business.
Right.
How important is education at that point? You know, how important is education given how we define education now? I think if you define it as something that, again, prepares people for the real world, prepares them for these bigger skills, then yes, education is always important.
Mm-hmm.
If your definition of education is like a list of facts and formulas, like no.
Mm-hmm.
No, you're making education irrelevant.
Mm-hmm.
But education is meant to prepare people. It's supposed to prepare people for the real world.
Right.
Right.
So,
you know, it's so funny and you bringing that up is here you went to school, you are matriculated in engineering,
mm-hmm.
right? And cloud computing and security. Mm-hmm. But yet your entrepreneurial business is health and fitness.
Right. Because that's...
I make no sense.
I mean, it's part of my life, you know. Yeah. That
maybe it's the tech thing. Maybe it's the tech component.
I think what the skills... Okay, so the transferable skills that I developed in my degree is what I do with... it seems disconnected outside looking in.
Yeah.
But for me, they're closely tied. Because when I am creating content for my website, I do a lot of research before writing. before it goes on my blog. I do read a lot of papers. I just like critique what's out there before I put it all together into a blog post or Instagram post. And that's something that I did, you know, I was doing during my PhD, like reading papers, critiquing work, and you know, what meaning can I extract from it. I think also being able to convey a message lives in both places, in you know, my PhD
like
work,
story.
Yeah, and you know, on my blog. So that's an example of where the transferable skills are more important.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Those
good.
That between, so yeah, yes, they're two different, I guess, like content areas, but from the back, it's kind of the same thing. Like you give me a problem, I'm approach it the same way. It'd be a food problem, an engineering problem, a fitness problem, I'm approach it the same way. You know, like research, critical thinking, you know, like sticking to it. Those are things that our students need to learn.
Okay.
Those are things that we need to foster and empower. How we do that? That's a couple.
Here's a pivotal question I want to ask you. Do you think that the level that you received your PhD, right? Do you think that your body kitchen is on the same level?
That's like a mental.
Right? Because when you have a degree in, which is by the world standards a great feat, which it is,
right?
But I see your body kitchen on that same level without a degree.
Right.
Reaching the same level of success, actually probably helping, you know, the same amount of people, if not more. But one, you have a degree, and one, you don't.
Yeah.
And you see this, I think, received or reached the same level of amount of success.
So from an academic point of view, I've gotten to the top of the thing.
Right. You would say that. The last dragon, you go up there, bro.
Yeah. When I started my PhD, my mother said to me, you know, you're going to do the PhD, then you're going to go to do your MBA. I'm like,
no!
Lady!
I'm glad you said that too. We're trying to get
you
know, to remember
your background. You do your master's, then you do your PhD, then you go to the MBA. I'm like, why? Funny thing is, so she just finished her PhD this year.
Congratulations.
Yes. She started hers after mine.
Okay.
She and my dad decided PhDs after
that's
I started mine.
Awesome.
There was a point in time that they were going to finish before me, and I was so I was like, what? How is this happening? So it almost felt like a race with my parents to finish before them. So she graduated with a PhD this year.
Congratulations, Bob.
Yeah, congrats. Yeah,
and
definitely.
After, like now that she's done it, she's like, I'm not going back to school for anything. Yeah. And she realized how ridiculous her MBA comment sounded like years before. Because when she said that to me years ago, she hadn't started the PhD.
Right.
And what did she get her doctoral?
She's like in business side, so she looked at like small and medium sized businesses and like creating culture around growth or something. So
it's like a leadership organizational something.
Okay.
Can we cut that part out?
Yeah, yeah. I know, because that's going to be embarrassing. You know what?
Yeah, we don't want to show this before the holidays.
Cut that part out.
I don't feel bad.
Because I've been in the same field, electrical engineering, for my entire academic career.
Okay, yeah.
And my family, maybe not my older sister, but my younger sister and my mom and my dad, I don't think we can explain to people what I do. My younger sister's like, I think he's a civil engineer. I think he's doing bridges. No.
Because the cloud thing is
home. So I've reached into the, go back to the question.
Yeah.
I feel like I've, at least for me, I've come to the top of the academic stuff, whatever.
Yes.
My body magazine is very young.
Okay.
It is very, very, very young. It has like a, if I were to compare it from like into like academic accomplishments, I see my body, my kitchen, like in like it's like in elementary school right now.
Mm.
It's like, yeah, it's very young.
Okay.
Still figuring out. You know, I have a vision for it, but it's It's a baby. It's a baby, and which is exciting to know that it's a lot, like a lot more to go. Which is, but it's also like kind of daunting. Like, damn, how do I do this? So I am grateful though that I'm able to help people at this scale right now. I think. As a brand, My Body, My Kitchen could help even more people. I've been thinking about, you know, how do I use technology to kind of to achieve that? So that is, I see it as like much more than what it is right now. I see it as much, much, much more than what it is right now.
Okay. Yeah. Visionary.
Yeah. What does that look like?
I have it in my head, but like how that happened?
I don't know.
You gotta go back to my guidance counselor there.
Yeah, my guidance is in elementary school, maybe second grade, right?
Right. See the growth. Because they said the jewel's in the journey.
Right. The destination.
Yeah, just like you with your training, like, I'm more interested, which is interesting. I initially wanted you to come over here for the New York City Marathon, but my purpose was really to say, well, what does it take to even get to that point? Right. Like the jewels is in like the training part. Like that's what I really want to know. Like how does someone do a New York City Marathon without injury?
Right.
Which is a great key. It's like a lot of people are like, oh, I just want to finish. Oh, I want to get this time. You're like, look, I just want to get it without injury, which I think was a kind of like a blessing in disguise. It kind of seemed.
Yeah, I just a lot of like people who I spoke to who I did tell that I was doing it, like, what time are you aiming for? I'm like, I'm not aiming for anything. I'm just injury free and enjoy it.
Yeah. Because I rarely hear people say, I enjoyed it.
Yeah, you know, some people will do it and they're like, never.
Yeah,
they're like, no. They will do like, you know, they wait like 3 years before they do it again. I'm like, I want to do this again. This is how do I, see? Can I sign, like, when do I sign? Because I had a great experience. I think, like, again, having your family and friends there, who understand what you went through, who saw you through training. So like my family, my friends, I had like, so my sister, my niece, and like three other friends. They showed up at four different locations along the route.
Oh, wow.
I saw them at mile 8, mile 18, mile 22, and at the end. Well, at the end, we couldn't really connect, but they were at the end.
Yeah.
So I'm in Brooklyn, I ran.
Legs so fresh.
Yeah. Mile 18, I felt like, yeah. I see you. I got a little teary-eyed, but like, I was all right, I kept moving. At mile 22, I saw them, I was just like, I kept running, I cried for like 5-6 blocks after.
Dang.
Just like, I kept running, but like, it's just like, crying, cause like everything. Like,
did you get replenished with that? You know what I'm saying? Cause I would probably want to cry, but I'm like, I need to hold these kids in. They're actually hydrated.
They're water stations every month.
Okay, like, okay.
So I cried like 5-6 blocks after that, and not from pain, just seeing them and like knowing that the race coming to an end and what it took me to get there and like how they supported me over the months and all that stuff. It just came out. When I crossed the finish line, I straight up wept. I got back into Central Park and those last few, you know, 100 yards or whatever. I was tired, but like, you know, that last wind.
Yeah.
Pick up the pace a little bit, cross the finish line. It's like, yeah. And then tears. I just like busted out crying. And I couldn't control myself. And this lady, she came up to me. She was from Foot Locker. She came up, she gave me a hug. She gave me my little blanket on. And she's like, you want me to take a picture? I was like,
yeah. I like had it on my phone. She's like, smile, like.
So I have pictures of me, like, it's tears. The journey is very important. You know what you do in the journey, how you experience that journey, really, really dictates when you get to your destination. You know, like how you experience that destination. A lot of people describe a marathon as the victory lap of your training. Depending on how you train, your victory lap would be either good or bad. And you probably, and like, I really didn't care about the time when I was running. Like, that wasn't on my mind. I was just taking it all in.
Wow.
One of the things that I learned as we close
this
out, that you shared with me from the marathon is when you were crossing the bridges and you said there's nobody around. And that's when you are with yourself and all you hear is the footsteps or the breathing, and that's when you really get to see you know, who you are, you get to self-reflect. That was inspiring.
Yeah.
I think that was, you know.
And I mean, there are a lot of that is metaphorical for many aspects of our lives, you know, like, yes, there will be people who will support you. Yes, they'll be there during training, but there are some things you just have to do by yourself. They are not going to run the race for you. They will be there along the route. They will, you know, have your beer ready for you at the end. They will, you know, have your food. You know, they'll make signs. They'll connect you to other people, but you have to run it. You have to, you know, actually run that race. And there'll be times when you don't see it. You don't see them. But that's when you rely on your perseverance. That's when you trust in your training, you trust in your ability to actually push through. And you know, the silence isn't scary. It's just more like a moment for you to reflect. And one runner said, like, when you get to the bridge, that part of the marathon, take that time to check in. It's like, check your breathing, check your posture. Look around, you know, like if you have a favorite song, put it on, and just reflect over it as you go through that tunnel. Like, don't get bogged down in the fact that, you know, it's steep or it's dark or there are no chairers. Like, that's your stretch. You just take that in and then prepare yourself for what's coming at the end of the bridge. Because the Queensboro Bridge coming up, that's the first time into Manhattan.
Right.
And it's a wall of sound. It's like a ton of people waiting for you at the end of that bridge.
Wow.
And you have to be prepared for it because, one, it's great, a lot of energy.
Yeah.
But it can mess you up. Because what happens is you get sucked into the energy and you forget your training, you forget your pace, and you just like, you start gunning it.
You get that boost.
So many people that destroys their race. They come out of that dark hour. They get a little bit of energy, and then they forget everything that they went through, what they're trying to do, and they just like gun it. And they gun it for like about 2-3 miles, and then that's it. And then you see them limping. You see them like, you know, they don't even get it into the Bronx, and they ruin their race because they didn't stick to what they're training, you know. This runner said, like, prepare yourself for what's coming next, because you're gonna have that, all that energy, that wall of sound, all the people, but don't forget that you're running your race, and don't get caught up with that, you know. So
good. That's, man, so many metaphors, man. I end on that because you got me thinking of some other things, man. I'm just like, wow, that just says so much about life in general. That's why I love running, because you have that time with self, and it's your time to kind of connect to your environment. But it has so many metaphors and so many symbolic things within it that you can just take on for life, man. And that's why I appreciate that simplicity of it. It's simple, but it's profound at the same time.
Yeah,
brother.
Final parting words.
Yes.
I mean, if it's anything that I would like listeners to take away from this is to, one, value the process, and don't beat yourself up about not being successful your first trial at something. Just keep at it, keep reflecting on, you know, yourself and who you are in those moments, and value what you're going through. You're gonna get there eventually. When you get there, it may not be what you thought it was gonna be, but you will get there. So value the process and be persistent.
See, I gotta learn from him too with being succinct. You know? I be going all off.
Yeah.
Scenarios, tangents. This guy gets everything done right within like 5 seconds.
Run the marathon, man. Run the marathon.
Yo. Yeah. What he said.
Yeah, yeah.
Cop.
Yo.
Good for you.
Right.
There you go.
What Bill said is profound. Because, I mean, he's just speaking on what he knows in his life. But like you said, man, you know, to quote him and the brother Nipsey Russell, the marathon continues, man. And it is your journey. It's your own journey. You're going at your own pace. but recognize, you know, like, I think, Sean, you spoke a lot about planning. Mm-hmm. And even if you go off the plans a little bit, the fact that you have something planned mm-hmm. and set aside for what you want, mm-hmm. I think that's what really stuck with me. And like, it could come tomorrow, it could come a month from now, it could come a few years from now, but to thinking long term, but also realizing that enjoy it. Mm-hmm. Enjoy it while it's here.
Yeah.
And that's what I learned from these brothers here, from this brother's experience. I'm like, I'm buzzing. Like I'm like, should I go on a run? Like, for real. Like, seriously, man. I just appreciate you even coming down and sharing your time.
You're welcome.
And even though you downplay your PhD, Dr. Peters, I don't, because you know that is an accomplishment. You took time out of your life to go through that process, and I love the fact that you're coming back and trying to share that community the best way you know how. And I appreciate that, but thank you.
You're welcome.
Got it.
Yeah.
I guess the overall that I got from Sean, in addition to everything you said, is I love the way Sean is analytical, and I love the way and that's something that I need to learn, mm-hmm. and I'm learning to evaluate, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Not quit,
yeah.
You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? You gave me support system, but the evaluation piece is what really helps me. And the fact you didn't quit. So with any of y'all out there, if you're learning anything, you know, think it through as best you can mm-hmm. before you involve it. Analyze all the areas that you have in your life mm-hmm. and then whatever you embark on, see how it fits. Mm-hmm. Because the key thing you said, it lines up with mm-hmm. what you're about. And that's what I get, brother. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah, yeah. So, family, thank you. Thank you for being with us. Thank you so much. We appreciate your time and energy spent with us. Hopefully it was as worthwhile for you as it was for us. And please stay tuned, please subscribe, Grand Rising Collective. You can catch me at K-E-Z-K-E-A-S-Y 773 on Twitter, and also DIX_KYLE on Instagram, and also I'm on YouTube as well, just Mr. Kyle Gibson.
Kind of. Oh, Sean.
Oh, yeah. Instagram?
You can find me on the interwebs. You can find me on Instagram, ESC Peters, and my blog's Instagram is My Body, My Kitchen. My blog's website is mybodymykitchen.com. On Facebook, My Body, My Kitchen. On YouTube, My Body, My Kitchen. Very consistent.
Yes, yes. Like engineering in them, man.
And on what's the thing? TikTok. My Body, My Kitchen.
Damn!
Okay.
Yeah, I'm on TikTok. Y'all need to get on TikTok.
Yeah, get on TikTok. I've heard.
I didn't even know Snap.
Yeah.
So, I mean.
Get on TikTok.
Yeah, TikTok?
Let's skip Snap and go
straight to TikTok. It's too much of the social media, yeah. Man. Listen, I'm just like Sean. Jesus Christ. Oh, man. Facebook, Kayade Bentley. YouTube, Kayade Bentley. I also have a channel, Perspective TV, where we do talks like this, giving perspectives on TV. I'm also have a channel, Candid Advisor, on YouTube. I'm going to start posting up videos on just life and analyzations and our culture. Instagram, it's Balagoon Logic.
Yeah.
I changed it from legit to logic.
Okay.
Now we're getting logical up in here.
Uh-huh.
And Twitter, Balagoon Logic. And then, you know, just search 4t's.org and my website, Wix, Kayade Bentley, where I have all my social media platforms right. as well, so you can reach me.
And family, we'll also have this stuff at the bottom of the,
yes.
The video, so that way you can go search, because we got a lot of surnames and hashtags and all this other stuff. But it's really just to make sure that you get as much content and as much access to what we're doing, because what we're doing is really really about community. So as we speak community, we try to live community as well.
Yeah. Baby, yeah. It don't say ready for this. You know I have patience.